that fast.
The thing is, the ball you kicked went your direction.
I'll try and make it not do that.
Okay.
I'll try and catch it before it does.
3, 2, 1. Hello, you have just sat down to watch a juggling video by Lewis Kennedy and Spencer Androli. If you are here by mistake, it's not too late to leave. But maybe you are here because you are also a juggler, or you are here to support someone you know. Or maybe you don't know what to expect, just like me when I travelled across the pond to stay with the family I barely even knew. Was I scared? Oh aye. But a big part of life is about adventures, and I think this is where you find the most amazing things. But if you are a juggler, you already know that. The journey starts here with me kicking Spencer in the bollocks. At the start, we both had different ideas about this video. Me, the smaller one of the two, my idea was to make a documentary on one of the world's best jugglers. Spencer had a much better idea. He wanted to make a video documenting the very first DB975 that won with clubs. And I asked him, oh, have you got it? And he's like, no. And I said, how many times have you tried it before? And he's like, oh, only a couple. But obviously he said it not in a Scottish accent. So for some reason he thinks he can get it. So we're going to attempt this in the video, as well as doing a little bit of a documentary about the main man, Spencer the Doctor.
Welcome to Tyler, everybody. Hope you enjoy this documentary. You're standing like a bodyguard.
Good. I'm so confused. I mean, guys, thank you.
Was it the one? Oh, yeah, here.
It was on the roof, yeah. Yeah, that one.
This one. Yeah, so we watched the D. It's like throwing.
It's kind of throwing on the side.
Yeah.
Interesting.
On that side of the...
Yeah, but it's like a pocket through the pattern.
Yeah.
And
if you look at your 7 clubs, for example, when you're doing that, it looks like you're using the same technique as you do with balls.
Right. It's much harder because it's more collision prone.
Yeah.
Because that pocket is way smaller to throw it through.
Funny stories or facts about Spencer. Actually, his sister was sitting right here in this room. She said that Spencer is Hannah Montana, which is probably not exactly what he would want to be known about, but that his friends at school know him as, you know, Spencer. Hey, he's this guy, he's this goofy kid. And then he has this secret life where he, you know, goes and puts on a cape and flies around the world and does these amazing things and is a world champion. But he kind of has these two lives going on at the same time. He's also, I feel like another thing about Spencer, he's a man without a country in a way, or without a land, because he grew up in the northern United States when he was young, and then he moved to South America and he lived there, you know, during his childhood and learned Spanish, but he wasn't really from there either. And his family, his mom is from Peru, but they're not ethnically Peruvian in different ways. I don't completely understand that. So they were kind of even outliers in that country. Then he moved to the southern United States in his kind of late childhood, early teenage years. So even going from the northern United States to the southern would be a whole culture shock. But then he's coming from South America. And then now they live at like a missionary base in a small town in the Bible Belt in East Texas, which is its own culture. So he's had a little bit of all of these different things, and he also is 6 foot however tall and red hair and juggles. I mean, there's no one like Spencer. And so, honestly, Spencer reminds me, there's a Maya Angelou quote that says, I belong nowhere, I belong everywhere. The cost is high, but the reward is great. At least I think that's how it goes. But that's a quote that I heard in a book by Brené Brown that we both read together. But it means a lot to me, just that, like, you're never going to fit in anywhere. And if you try, you're going to lose who you are in that process. But because you're never going to fit in, you belong. And I think Spencer really embodies that, because he is exactly who he is. and that is unlike anyone else, but that's what makes Spencer Spencer and why he's outstanding. He's never going to fit in because he stands out, and that's what makes him outstanding.
Okay, so some of you might be thinking, what is a DB97531? Well, it's a 7-object trick where the first object thrown is the last object caught, the second object thrown is the second last caught, and so on. Now, this has never been done with 7 clubs, or not back to a qualifying pattern. Moritz Rosner has done the DB to a collect, but this is vastly easier than having to regain the cascade afterwards. The mechanics of this trick is very unique. Mathematically, all the pops should peak at the same time. In other words, all the pops should stop at the same time before falling back down into the pattern. Definitely one of the nicest looking tricks out there. And this is just one reason why this trick with 7 balls had a legendary status behind it. Thomas Dietz was the first to have filmed it back to a qualifying pattern in 2003 in Thomas Dietz 6. Ben Beaver told Peter Bone that he did it back in 2002 at the BJC, but he didn't state that this was his first DB. Therefore, he may have done it in 2001. Spencer was born in 2001. Now, how cool would it be if Ben did the first DB on the same day Spencer was born? The official world record for the trick with balls is by Ofek Schneer with 26 rounds, but Ivan saw Ofek get 31 rounds on his first attempt at the IJC in 2017. This run was filmed in 2016, and even to this day, no one has gotten more than 5 rounds of the DB with balls. This is just another reason why Ofek Schneer should be in the Bible. 5 jugglers have done the DB with Rins: Laura, Jonah, Ivan, Howshield, and Spencer himself, but only 3 of them have it on camera. The concept of this trick can be done with any number of props. Alex Barron is the only person to have qualified the 8-ball equivalent, which is FDB97531, and a few jugglers have gotten the 6-club equivalent, B97531, Manuel Mitash being the first to qualify it back in April 2008. With Ivan's help, these are all the B95D1s we managed to find online. Very recently, Moritz Rosner got 2 rounds of B95D1 back to the qualifying pattern. But he has also done 3 rounds, but that was to a collect, and that was in 2021.
Cool. And you want to try DB?
Yeah. I'll need like a kind of a practice session sort of to warm up.
Yeah.
Which could last an hour.
I don't know. Yeah, of course.
But we could film cool tricks. That's like a really cool space.
Is it?
Yeah, let me see if that area is free. Literally, the stadium there. It's like that tall.
Wow, Spencer!
Yeah. So I'm like, that's the only spot in Tyler. Hello, I wanted to ask, is the stadium, what do they call it, the big high ceiling area, is it open today?
Yeah, open.
Okay, awesome. Sounds great. Thank you.
Are we going to go downtown today?
Actually, we could. Yeah, so this place closes at 5.
So maybe let's go there first.
We can go there first, I can change shirts.
I don't want to hammer, I don't want to tire you out. Yeah. EB is going to be a...
It's going to be a beast. Yeah. Just willing it.
Yeah.
Chicken willing it.
I can do a B9, 7531.
Can you?
In there?
Yeah.
Yeah, I can throw it, yeah. But not the D.
Yeah.
Not the D B9. It's like 4 days here.
Did he get these made?
Oh.
Abby Brooksy.
Oh, yeah, I don't know who that is. So.
He's been stealing people's balls.
No, the story about these is Gregory, over the pandemic.
Yeah.
He ran out of leather. So he had all these that he had made mistakes on.
Wow.
All these scraps. So he's like, oh, I can put all these scraps together. Because what's funny, it's like, I recognize a friend who, a friend's logo from Peru.
Yeah.
Yeah, El Jaglista, that's my friend Jonathan.
Is it?
Jonathan Sahiux.
Yeah, and then there's Tai Tojo around. You're like, oh, Professor X.
Who is AJH? Who is SCT?
SCT.
Who's Just Joe?
Just Joe. It's Just Joe. It's we just know Joe. Who it is. It's Joe.
It's not Showers, is it? It'd be cool if it was.
Or what if it was Joe Fisher?
Oh, it was Joe Fisher, yeah.
I don't know.
Okay. We got an LC. Lewis Carson.
Lewis Kaysen, yeah.
Oh, Kaysen. Is that Lewis Kaysen?
Yeah, I don't know.
Could be.
Oh, man. Lewis Kaysen needs to go to juggling festivals. He's funny.
Do you hear that?
Lewis Kaysen, come to juggling festivals. I want to meet you.
Me too.
Yeah.
Nice enough steel.
Oh, wait. Let's go! Go! Oh, one I get online, which it's like, I don't fully answer because it's like, it's not the case. They're like, how much do you practice a day? And I'm like, I don't practice every day. I practice like a few times a week. I space it out because I kind of like do a hardcore practice. Then I rest a little bit and then I do another hardcore practice. And yeah, and I juggle like 3 or 4 times a week. So, for warming up with juggling, I definitely tried to stretch. Then I usually grab 3 balls. I like going balls, rings, clubs in order. Yeah, and then just warming up throws, I do a ton of side swaps because I think they're very good to make you a more flexible juggler, if I were to say. Like, my entire juggling, like, feel great from the start if I try to go through all these side swaps I kind of have.
Bloody hell. Bloody hell. Bloody hell. No way. No way. Bloody hell. Are you serious? Oh, you little monkey.
Oh. A lot of times I do pretty, you know, pretty technical stuff. When I have the ceiling height, I always do technical stuff. It just motivates me because I have the height. But yeah, it's hard to say technical stuff because I like innovative technical stuff a lot of the time. I don't know. With practice, it's a lot of time, like, kind of how I feel at the moment. Like, yeah, I do take days off, right? Like, I'm not a juggler who juggles every day. My body couldn't do that. Like, personally, I'm like, I think I'm very, like, hardcore. When I practice, it's very focused, I think. Yeah, and also I need some time off to think of the tricks, I think. Mental training has helped me, you know, just thinking of the feel of the trick. When I come back, it's always better. So I think rest helps a lot. So yeah, but I'm not, I usually go up to 7 balls to start. I've started doing a little more 8s and 9 here and there, but usually I stop at like 7 and then I, move on to rings because I'm always excited to do rings. I feel like they're a lot of fun after I do balls. I kind of start with 5 rings and then go till 8 rings, and with clubs I go till 7 clubs as well. My practice, like, I guess general structure, like, of my practice, I feel like the first, yeah, I do the structured parts for 30-40%. And then the rest, I just have time to kind of play around and try hard tricks that sometimes it can be 10 to 20 minutes of trying a trick that I want to get, or maybe just focusing. Yeah, there's other times I just have like a focus time. Like, for example, if I'm working on 7-club back crosses, right? I do drills to help the 7-club back crosses, and I have a structured way of approaching that trick. But that's after I've already warmed up with the general practice. And then there's sometimes I test myself and I'm like, oh, let me do 100 catches of 9-6-6 with 7 balls, which is a common thing, which is, yeah, I memorize how many rounds it takes. It's 34 rounds to get over 100 catches of 9-6-6. So I usually, I'm like, oh, let me get 34 rounds back to the pattern. I test myself like that sometimes just to check on my endurance and check on consistency. So I do those kind of tests for sure once every session in different ways. Like my most common one is 100 catches of 7 clubs when I try to collect it, right? Like that's my aim to stay consistent at. So yeah, I'm like, consistency is very important in my practice session, I would say. Because I'm like, I want to be a consistent juggler and I want to hit these tricks consistently if I can. So yeah, I do test myself in that way. Yeah.
Flippin' hell. Did you just see that? Oh, flippin' hell. Right, I'll quickly set the good camera up. Are you serious? That's insane.
Does it look good?
It looks fucking...
Okay. Yeah,
right, okay.
Set up your camera.
Yes. After around 1 hour of general practice, Spencer attempts today's main goal, which is DB with clubs. Spencer says he has tried DB for jokes at conventions but has never had a proper session with it, until now. This was Spencer's 6th attempt and it looked bloody great to me. These are all of Spencer's attempts from a 28 minute session. There are 56 attempts in total, with the first attempt at the top left and the last attempt bottom right. These two in red are the only two he didn't qualify the 7 clubs. These in yellow are the attempts he didn't release the DB due to an unstable pattern. To me, they looked right. This just shows you how solid the base pattern needs to be before you can release the DB. I have never seen this kind of consistency with 7 clubs, probably because I've never made a documentary on Gatto. These in green were his best attempts going back into the cascade. In this attempt, Spencer forgot what he was doing, but we should definitely try and inspire him to get a one high, four low 360. After these 56 attempts, he took a 10 minute break where we sat down and discussed some of the problems. These 26 attempts in pink are all the attempts where the D collides with another club, usually the last 7. This is more than half the attempts if you take away the non-qualified and the failed release attempts. Therefore, if he fixes this problem, this will massively statistically increase the chance of him getting the DB.
It's like you, like I think about the trick a lot, yeah. And then I'm like, go through that one, high.
What do you think about the first throw?
I don't know where to throw it, so it doesn't hit the other club.
What I noticed when I was up there, times it didn't collide, it tended to go in front of the pattern.
Oh.
As if you were naturally trying to do like the 7 a bit more, oh, the 7, the D.
Interesting, yeah.
It looked like it was subconscious. Did you feel it like that?
I was thinking I maybe was doing it, but I also see if I do that, that my arm's in that position, so I don't have the time to, so.
Pull back, yeah. He carried on for another 70 minutes, with a total time of 1 hour 48 minutes, including the break. He didn't get the DB that day, but he did get a new world record for it, which was 3 catches afterwards. In this 1 hour 48 he attempted 7 clubs 151 times, only not qualifying the clubs 7 times. His incredible endurance and consistency is massively going to help him with this DB mission. So he may have not gotten it this session, but we plan on having another DB session before I go home, so fingers crossed.
Oh, bloody hell.
You know, it all starts like a game, no? In between his cousin, his older cousin, and visiting Peru, and then, you know, it's a fun thing to do with a cousin, and learning to juggle and play with his older cousin. Yeah, I don't know, but I remember when he was like 7, sort of like that. He started getting interested in science things, you know? And I am a scientist, I'm a biologist. So I'm like, oh yeah, that would be great, you know? And then he started collecting rocks, and everything was rocks and everything, you know, very intense, you know? And it's like a lot of interest, you know? And then collecting coins and, you know, the bills, you know? And also with a lot of intensity, you know? And, you know, and then he got to juggling, you know, and also a lot of intensity, and it kept, you know, it stayed with him, no?
I'm just really, like, happy he's my brother, because he's a very good human being, and I'm really proud of him. Yes. Girls, anyone, if you're single, Spencer's single, he's a great guy. Spencer, we're trying to find you a girlfriend. There's always like someone like being like, good job, Spencer, you did so good. And I think that motivates him to like keep going and keep pushing for better and like improvement in his juggling. And also just like knowing that he in a way is like different, and he is shaping his own future with his juggling, I think. Like, I think it's fascinating that, like, he started off by, like, getting himself places, like, fundraising, and we have an uncle that he would support him, and he would, like, give us money so that we could go to WJF, IJA, Austin. After, like, he turned 18 or something, he was like, okay, so now you get to, like, it's in your control now. And now people are just flying him out places, and like, I think it's like mind-blowing that they're flying him out to England, and like, he's never been to England or Europe, but like, because of his skill, he's able to go places, and I think it's really awesome. I think like, just the beginning years of him like going to the WJF and just getting his name out there, like, it's kind of weird being the little sister and seeing your brother nervous, because it's like, big brother is like protector. And so he would see Jason, or he would see Vova and other people, and he would be like, oh my goodness, I'm like standing here in front of them, and I'm like, cool. Because like, I didn't know like the magnitude of it, but like, they were his inspirations.
So you just got done playing Combat Headquarters. What are your thoughts?
Well, it was pretty awesome. It's actually my first convention ever and my first WJF. And it was pretty fun, even though I didn't know the rules really well. But I got to play it well. And
Nobody knows the rules. It's okay. What do you look forward to the most at WJF 9?
I like to watch the freestyle competitions of... Yeah, the advanced. I wish there were like freestyle and juniors, but
This is your chance to show off here, though, in front of everyone else watching at the convention. And then when you work hard and you get better, then you can come back and do the freestyle in the advanced competition. How's that sound?
I was thinking about that.
All right. Well, good luck. Thanks for chatting with us today.
Well, 12-year-old Spencer wasn't bloody lying when he said that he was thinking about that. Because 2 bloody years later, he competed in the advanced freestyle competition. And he didn't only do that, he competed in the overall bloody championship at WJF 11. The way Jason shows how juggling can be done is absolutely bloody inspiring. The whole idea of the WJF and the way the videos are put together is so hype. especially for young inspiring jugglers. Jason Garfield, the founder and president of the WGF, deserves some kind of super beast reward for his impact on technical juggling. You could even arguably say that Jason has had more impact on juggling than anyone else, arguably. Here is a 2-minute clip of WGF 11, Spencer's very first competition in the advanced program. Just imagine being a young, bloody inspiring juggler watching this video.
All right, we are here at the warm-ups for the advanced short programs. We have three competitors, Spencer, Jonah, and Delaney. Jonah is he's a pro at this point. He's won the whole overall competition in 2013. We're going to see if he can do it again in 2015. Spencer and Delaney, both newcomers here to the advanced championships. How are you feeling right now? What's going through your head?
Kind of nervous. My routines are some risky parts, but...
What's the riskiest move, you think?
Pancakes to a half shower to a full reverse. I kind of practice on the road, like by my house. When it comes to rings, it's kind of my weakness because I can't really practice them outside. It's usually kind of windy.
So here we have Spencer Androli, currently 14 years old. He's won the WJF Juniors Championship at only 13 years old, and he's the youngest competitor to ever enter the Advanced Overall Championship.
What do you think? We're about to find out the results of the Advanced Freestyle.
We're going to start with the 5-ball freestyle. Third place to Spencer for a 97531 up the back into back crosses, which was pretty dope. Second place, we gave Jonah Boffin at Greenhouse for his 6x4, 3 up 720, into a 5 up 360, into back crosses, connections everywhere. First place, we awarded Delaney Bayless with the 5 up 540 into back crosses, monster trick. Delaney Bayless, first place. For the 7-ball freestyle competition, third place, we awarded Delaney Bayless for a back cross flash to a collect. Jonah Boffin at Greenhouse pulled off a perfectly executed 5 up 720. And first place goes to Spencer Androli for his 8x6 into a 4-up multiplex into a DB97531.
Great job, man.
For the 5-club freestyle, Spencer Androli got third place with his 97531 into flats, which was amazing looking. Jonah Botvinnik Greenhouse got second place for his 975 all in singles 360. First place with a 3-up 540, Delaney Bayless.
At WGF 11, Spencer won bronze at his first ever advanced competition. 1 year later, at WGF 12, Spencer came second in the advance. But he didn't stop there. Spencer won the advanced program at WGF 13, 16, and 17.
Hi, Rich. It's Spencer's juggling entertaining.
Where are we going, Spencer boy?
We're going to Austin.
Going to see Zachy boy.
I'm actually really looking forward to seeing him, man.
Oh, his act's so good.
Texas used to be its own country.
Did it?
Uh-huh. And then joined the US.
Before going to the Austin Juggling Convention, Spencer took me to the state capital of Texas, which is apparently the biggest state capital in the US. A couple of interesting facts about Texas. Texas is larger than any European country, and Dr. Pepper was invented in Texas in 1885. And also, Tesla just built a giant factory in Austin. And this is where the next Top 40 discussion will be held.
Me and Hobart.
What's your favorite thing about Texas so far?
Spencer 7 clubs. You're very, very close
there. The entire state of Texas?
The entire state of Texas, yeah. Spencer 7 clubs. And Spencer's mom's been very nice.
And for the camera, can you show us your 5 hoop toss juggle? 5. What's your favorite thing about Lewis Kennedy?
He's Batman.
What's your favorite food?
My favorite food?
Yes.
I go for a steak.
Steak? Okay.
Doctor Who is my dad. I love nachos. Spencer and I grew up similarly, like in a Christian household. So we're very wholesome. There's like no swearing, no dirty talk growing up. So when I went to festivals, a lot of the time it felt like us two could understand each other in that way, whereas everybody else was just kind of like doing whatever they want. But like when something weird would happen, it seemed like I could always like look at him and he would be like, oh yeah, that was weird. I don't know what to do in this situation. He's always been consistent with what he does. He's just become better and better. So the tricks he's doing with those things are becoming more and more difficult. And just his consistency level was always pretty high. Like I'd seen videos of him before, but you assume on video, like it's not as consistent. Like you take cuts and whatever. But seeing him in person, like you really see how solid he has all of these tricks. But now it's like the same thing. But now he's doing the same things he was doing with balls, but now he's doing them with clubs with similar consistency. So it's cool to see that growth. I think I was kind of like a bit of an odd one out because everyone was working more towards technique. But when it came to that group of people like Noah Schmeisner, Jonah Buffnick-Greenhouse, Delaney Bayless, Jack Denger, all of those jugglers working together and sharing their tricks online, I feel like that's just constantly motivating each person to keep going. Like when Delaney posts a trick, it inspires Spencer to be like, oh, I gotta keep going. Delaney's getting this trick. Like I should try and like step it up or something. Or like Jack does something like ups the record with 7 club back crosses. Spencer's probably thinking like, oh, I should like qualify that. You know, like it just like keeps going. If it was just Spencer doing it, I'm sure you would get bored. Like there's no competition, and the fun part of juggling in this regard is the competition. It's like a friendly competition.
Hi, how are you?
He's very good, isn't he?
Oh, yeah, we already took a picture and a video.
Like,
the Lauga videos, the improving series, is one of the best juggling series ever. With the music, it's the most hype videos ever.
Austin Juggle Fest was a lot of fun. On the long drive back, Spencer was telling me how much of an impact YouTube videos made to his juggling. These are some of his favorite YouTube videos.
In the beginning, Anthony's progress was normal. He would become discouraged once in a while, but we managed always to hang in there. I noticed that after a few weeks,
for the third year in a row, the world's best jugglers have traveled to Las Vegas to compete in the most technically demanding competition they've ever faced. The time has come for WJF 3. We touch Vova when it comes to club moves and connections.
Two amazing moves back to back.
I can't even believe what we're seeing here. Three in one hand and two in the other. Oh, into a beautiful three-up multiplex 360.
He's the only competitor this year to qualify flat throws.
Now that's what we're talking about. Wes raised the bar there.
This is a very high-risk move here.
And now he's going for seven clubs. Nobody has ever qualified seven clubs in a full routine juggling competition before.
He's got seven clubs down better than any other competitor in history.
That is probably the longest and highest scoring six-ball routine we've ever seen in competition. This has never been done in WJF competition before, not in the full program. Oh, into an amazing two-stage multiplex 360.
And once again, Thomas Dietz executes a flawless routine.
It's just incredible.
I can't believe this video is almost 14 years old. I can remember it coming out and being super inspired to juggle. This is Juggling Hero by Ori Roth and Bob Mualem. It's a hard word to say that one, Mualem. This is a classic from the past. After we got home from Austin Juggle Fest, unfortunately I only had one day left with Spencer before I fly back to England. Spencer performed two shows at Austin, as well as doing a Renegade. Neither of us had enough energy to do a second DB session, which crazy sucks. You might ask, why didn't we plan to do a DB session before Austin? Well, Spencer is one bloody busy monkey. He had an exam for school, he had training with his passing partner Paul, he had a random Azerbaijan school performance, and he was hired to do a TV commercial, which I wasn't allowed to film at.
Circus is fun, but it's not something that you should have in your backyard. I'm thankful we chose Yosemite for our roof. It looks great, they did an amazing job. But I guess some people like the circus.
In a world filled with chaos and the unexpected, you can always count on Yosemite for your roofing needs. Isn't that right, Nancy?
I wish there was a juggler called Nancy so I could make up some kind of funny joke. The thing that kept Spencer the busiest while I was there for those 2 weeks is that he was protecting me from the 5'5" spiders that they have in Texas.
Let's go to war, right, man.
Here's your weapon, Lewis.
Okay, danke. Yeah. Oh, Spencer, you're a brave man. It was absolutely 5'5".
5'5".
This was last night, sir. Oh, what? Shit!
But we did really look at some of Spencer's DB attempts, as well as looking back at Ivan's documentary from JuggleVision in 2017, where he also attempted the DB.
Yeah, there he did the 5 and the 7.
Same height.
A little too close, yeah. Oh, that one looked...
It's the same, yeah.
He just can throw... He throws way higher than I can. Like, he's way more comfortable with that, I can see.
Yeah.
That's why he threw him high. I scrunch it all together.
Yeah.
Oh, that was great. That was good.
That was much better.
Hey!
I bet you weren't expecting me to phone you with Spencer next to me.
No, I wasn't.
You are in the interview, Ivan.
Oh.
We had a good 1 hour discussion with Ivan about training and interesting facts all related to the DB. As Spencer, Ivan and I, we were going to the British Juggling Convention in 1 week. We decided to have the next DB session there, as Ivan would be able to join in on the action. So let's shoot forward a week to the BJC.
Felix, could you throw me my tripod?
This was Spencer's first time in Europe, so obviously I took him to Nando's. And I introduced him to British fish and chips. Spencer was mega loved at BJC. I don't think he was expecting that amount of attention. Someone took their kid out of school just because he wanted to meet Spencer. Spencer's workshop on 4 key ways to improve your juggling. It felt like half the convention was there. Spencer also broke his 7 club record in the Numbers League competition, which is the second longest run of 7 clubs in BJC history, second to Gatto back in 2000.
Guys, are you guys jugglers?
Sorry?
Are you jugglers?
No.
Oh, sorry. Okay. Sorry.
Are you crazy?
Are you ready for DB day? Today might be the day you get it.
Yeah, could be nice.
Show me some enthusiasm, Ivan. Come on.
Let's just get the trick. Yeah. Come on.
Whoa! Nice, guys.
Alright, so me and Spencer, we were going to attempt the DB 97531 with 7 clubs. That has never been done before. It has happened to a collect where you just do the trick and then catch everything, but it has never occurred that anyone does the trick and then goes back into the pattern. And there's many reasons for that, because first of all, 7 clubs itself, it's really, really difficult. Just the amount of jugglers that can juggle 7 clubs, like semi-controlled in a way, is very, very limited. And then it's also how high you have to throw. So, in juggling, we have something called side swaps, which basically represent how high the throw has to be. So, when we think about that, the DB 97531, it actually means 13, 11, 9, and so on. So the high throw is how high you would have to throw if you juggled 13 clubs.
Left and L, Ivan.
And so far, throughout the entire history of club juggling, with 5 clubs, no one has ever thrown higher than 13. And with 6 clubs, only one person has ever thrown that height, and that was Jack Denger doing a 6 club, 1 high, 5 low, and then a 360 back into the pattern. And with 7 clubs, that has never occurred. So far, it has only been a couple of moves with the height of a B, so 11 clubs, which was by Spencer himself, with doing the B9753. And also Kento Tanioka with the 5 up 720, and also Håvard Vidsen with the B6666. Even though not all of those tricks were back into a qualify, as we call it, where you juggle for long enough, but they all went back into the 7-club pattern. So now, we're attempting this crazy feat, and the thing is, with 6 clubs, it's hard enough in itself to throw to that height, even with 5 clubs. But when you juggle 7 clubs, the pattern is so much quicker that you have to develop the same amount of power as you do with 5 and 6 clubs, but you have way less time on you, which makes it a lot harder. And then it's just more clubs. It becomes a lot tighter, kind of the space that you have to hit. And then it's just the re-entry when you go back into the pattern, which in itself is just insanely difficult. If we accomplish this, it will for sure be the hardest trick that's ever been done with 7 clubs when you go back into the pattern. If it will be the hardest 7-club trick ever, maybe. Still, maybe Masahiro's 7-club Alberts will beat this, but this is at least top 2, if not top 1, of the hardest 7-club tricks that has ever occurred, ever, in the juggling history.
Nice, thanks guys.
As you guys have probably guessed by now, Spencer and Ivan didn't get their DB today. Spencer did get these 2 nice attempts, which they are briefly going to analyze. That's a hard word to say. Analyze. You know what I mean. You know the word I mean.
So now I'm going to basically analyze what I think about your juggling. Yeah.
I just have to sit here.
Yeah. I mean, I think the attempts today were pretty... I think it's finally clicking. The heights... Yeah. I realize it just has to explode upward.
Yeah.
And like, I think it got to a place where it was comfortable that I threw the heights up.
Yeah.
And it's like, ooh, it's all coming back down at a right timing. Yeah. I'm finally feeling that.
Yeah. Like in general, I'm not sure what the best way to go forward with this.
Yeah.
Like maybe practice a lot of high throw tricks.
Yeah, consistency with those.
Yeah, consistency with high club tricks. Because it's a lot easier to be accurate when you throw really high if you don't have to give it 100%.
Right.
So if you can make it so that when you throw at 90% and it's high enough, then I think it will become a lot easier.
Yeah. What's interesting with my attempts today, it's like at the beginning it felt super solid, like the pattern. And as I got more and more exhausted, the pattern, like starting the pattern, got worse and worse.
Yeah.
And it's like, so it's like you want your 7-club pattern to be so solid that even when you're tired of like trying the trick, you can still make it work, I guess.
Yeah, and that's also a big factor because at the end there, I think I actually attempted DB97531 maybe like 1 out of 6 attempts or something. Like at the end, it wasn't good. And you can imagine that I have to use 6 attempts, maybe a span over 4 minutes, to attempt it once. But if my record with 7 clubs was like 1,000 catches like Gatto, then maybe every other attempt. That would increase the chance of getting it a ton. But with 5 clubs and 3 clubs, you know, then you basically do a semi-good attempt every single time. But with 7, the pattern has to line up perfectly and... Yeah.
All right. No, we're good. That was good questions.
Yeah. I can answer off camera.
Yeah, we can talk about that. No, I know you can. Yeah. Those are great questions.
Thanks so much. Yeah. Mama. Cricky, buddy, mama mia. Now I get to drive you around, Spencer boy.
Oh, yeah.
Hey!
Felix, you can do the filament.
Oh, I bet I'm filming here in 4 feet.
The wheel on the other side, man. What should you do with this car?
We don't need seatbelts, but we're not going anywhere. Just record.
Okay, we're good.
You don't have to do it anymore.
Oh. We're here just filming.
Put the camera about here now.
We haven't actually decided where we are.
Right, I think Dominic, you are the responsible.
Oh, okay.
Yeah,
woo! Does that count?
One of my favourite things about juggling is recoveries and corrections. I knew going into this documentary, Spencer was a beast at corrections from his videos, but seeing someone juggle in person is very, very different. I had no idea how good Spencer was and how consistent he was. Now I want you to look at these club corrections from Harvard. They are truly insane. Spencer's corrections are different. They don't look as wacky, but he is very consistent with his corrections. More so than any other juggler I've ever seen in person. No matter how good you are at juggling, everyone needs to constantly correct when they're juggling. Matthew Tiffany once said to me years ago, sometimes the correction is part of the trick. And I think that is such a good statement when watching people juggle. Me personally, I usually love watching the correction more than the trick itself. There are lots of different types of juggling corrections, and 99% of them are subconscious. Some of them are even impossible to explain. Obviously there are hundreds, but let's look at these three with balls. The main one being dwell time correction, aka fudgeability and pattern maintenance. Then there's catch position, how good you're at catching wide throws or on different planes. Then there's body position, making little micro adjustments to make the pattern easier for you. As shown on the screen, you can see all the different corrections all happening at the same time, and they're all affecting one another. You can see this in the overlap of the circles. Now let's look at clubs. With clubs, there are more. Grip adjustment, positioning the club in your hand so you can make an easier throw. Club catching position, so the orientation of the club at the catching point. Throw spin adjustment, this is only really used when you don't have enough time to do a decent grip adjustment. You are basically finding the center of gravity of the club before releasing it so it doesn't pin off anywhere. So let's just look at these three with clubs. Let's completely ignore ins, or we'll be here all day. So when juggling clubs, all the ball corrections we mentioned previously are also used in club juggling. Like previously stated, all these corrections are happening simultaneously. So if we look at the area in the center in comparison to the previous area, you can see it's much smaller, as the brain has even more things to think about as you're juggling clubs, not balls. So we can change the size of these circles independently on how good someone is at that specific correction type. This diagram shows you a good ball juggler juggling clubs. When he's juggling balls, the club corrections aren't used. In real time, all these corrections are fluctuating when you're juggling. Think about the world's best one club juggler, who can manipulate one club with incredible ease, but he doesn't juggle. So he will have a massive grip adjustment circle, but because he doesn't juggle, his dwell time level is super low. Therefore, he cannot make the most of his grip adjustment skill, because when juggling three clubs, it feels very fast for him. Whereas a juggler who can juggle five clubs, three clubs will feel super slow. Therefore, their center correction area will be vastly bigger than the world's best one club juggler. Unfortunately, I think your juggling technique has a lot to do with how big you can potentially get your circles. Now, I want to show you how Harvard's corrections differ from Spencer's by using this diagram idea. Harvard's technique is very bally. Basically, he's a ball juggler who can juggle clubs. Look at how big his center area is when he's only juggling balls. It's bloody massive. So let's throw clubs into the mix. Harvard is crazy good at catching clubs in all orientations, and you can see that this barely affects his center circle because he's that good at catching clubs. But due to his juggling technique, his accuracy isn't great, still incredibly high because it's Harvard, but it's just not the best. It is also more difficult for him to correct his club grip mid-juggle. You can see in the diagram that five of the techniques are completely overlaying the spin and throw adjustment circle. Therefore, Harvard can only improve his corrections if he increases the circle. But like previously stated, I think technique plays a massive role in the size of these circles. And once your technique is built in, it's very hard to change it. And even if you do, it's hard to keep your current juggling level. I don't want this to demotivate anyone with that statement, because you can improve your juggling in so many different ways. Juggling isn't only about becoming the world's best technical juggler. Okay, let's move on to Spencer's diagram. Before I met Spencer, I would have guessed that his diagram would be more club dominated compared to Harvard's. But after seeing that Spencer basically treats his clubs like balls, I think his diagram will look more like this. Now here are a few clips from Spencer's WGF16 club program. You must realise this is a live competition and he's under pressure. I want you to pay close attention to his corrections. Look at the speed at which he can correct. Spencer's diagram is more equal throughout the correction types than compared to Harvard's. So you can see Harvard's center circle is bigger than Spencer's, which means he is better at corrections than Spencer. No, wait, listen to this. Remember, these circles all fluctuate. And what I believe is because Spencer's circles are so big, when they are fluctuating, the center area doesn't change that much. Whereas when Harvard juggles, because the circles are all different sizes, the center area will change more often, depending on the situation of Harvard's juggling pattern. And this is why I think Harvard can do the world's most insane correction, but only once in a blue moon. Whereas Spencer can do crazy corrections consistently, but he can't do a 1 in a million correction inside a blue moon. This is probably another reason why Spencer's corrections look so effortless compared to Harvard's, because he is not correcting by overcompensating one of the correction types like Harvard. I love both these juggling techniques. There isn't a right or wrong way to juggle, unless you're trying to achieve a certain style of juggling. Spencer is the only juggler I've ever seen in person whose technique appears to be more club dominated, but he has the ball correction level of a ball juggler's technique. It's very strange, it's very, very fascinating. Every juggler has their own technique, but Spencer seems to have two in one. I feel like his corrections are so well rounded that his corrections can easily go unnoticed. If you want to reach your juggling potential, technique is vital. Obviously, good technique means good throws, good body posture, and all of that marky-larky, but it's also very important for your corrections. Now let's go on to an interview with Spencer, where he's going to talk about what motivates him to juggle. I am going to overlay my favourite 7 club corrections from Spencer, so you have something to visually look at when listening to The Boss.
I think what motivates me to juggle, it's something that I'm truly feel like I'm good at. I mean, that sounds like a bad answer. It sounds depressing, like I'm not good at anything else. No. It's like juggling has been very therapeutic for me. I don't know. It's just make me feel fulfilled. I don't know, like internally, just feeling consistent at something and like just seeing progress. And also it's so much fun. It never feels like I'm having to do it. It's more like I've established a routine and it's like, I just get lost in my practice space and I just, you know, just love it.
In this documentary, I don't really talk about how good Spencer is at all three props. I talk about his balls and his clubs, but I never mention his rin skills. Here are some of my favorite rin tricks from Spencer.
When I started juggling, I was 8. I lived in Peru, actually. My mom is Peruvian, so we live with my family down there. And my cousin Lucas Sileri, he got me into juggling. And I kept practicing from there. It was kind of strange. I remember learning 3 balls in the first day, like flashing it. And I don't know why, I just got super interested in juggling and just obsessed with it. I'm like, I remember days when I was a kid and I had no responsibilities, right? Or little responsibility. I could just spend the whole day just juggling. And so I felt like, I think I did that for a while. Oh, then I would just YouTube juggling. And I would find in Peru, it's like it was so far from the States. So all the juggling videos I would find, I would remember. And there were like all these jugglers I would see, like Lewis Kennedy. They were like celebrities to me. Like truly, if I'm being honest, I was like, wow. Like I heard I was moving to the United States when I was almost 12, 11, when I moved here to Texas. And I was just like, okay, then it's like maybe I can go to the WJF, and that year we managed to go, and I was beyond excited because I was gonna see all these people I saw on YouTube, right? And I can tell you my first day ever at WJF, it was WJF 9, right? And oh, that was like forever. Like it was like you were meeting all your celebrities in one day, and they were telling you to hang with them. Like it was the craziest thing. It was funny because it's like now I look back, I'm like, oh, that was cute. Like as a kid, I was like, I remember meeting Jonah, and I had seen his videos before, and I was like, oh my gosh, it's Jonah. He's amazing. Like he's so good. And and then we started hanging out, and then they're like, we're gonna film a festival video, and I'm like, oh cool. They're like, you want to be in it? I'm like, heck yeah. So it was like, it just felt so inviting because I was like, this is awesome. And it's like, I've always been around adults that are jugglers. And this time was like, it was Jonah, it was Noah, it was Nick Thomas. I think Tanner Alder showed up. And it's like, wow, kids my age. Well, they were always a little older than me, like, but I'm like, wow, kids my age juggle. And they want to hang out with me too. And they're really good. Like Noah would do DBs at WGF 9. And I was like, they're so good. Like, and it's like, it pushed me. I'm like, yes. Like, yeah. So, yeah. So at the end of that day, I was like, just super happy that, that group, I guess, included me. And also, like, there were people my age that juggled like me too. It was the best. And then I was like, I remember at the end of the first day, the climate in Vegas is way drier than here, right? And anywhere else I've been. So my hands at the end of the first day, I had like these minor cuts going into my hands because I had juggled all day because I was so happy. And I wanted to compete in all the games, every single one of them. I was so like, and so I did all of them. And I was like, I had no idea if I could maybe do well in the game, but I was like, forget it, I'm here, let's try it.
Well, I remember first meeting Spencer in El Paso. So he was probably 2016, I think. And he was 13 years old. And he was just this excited little redhead kid who could do five balls, Mills mess. And he was just, you know, this light. It would run around the room and absorb every trick he could get from everybody. And there were so many good jugglers there. You know, Jugglemissimo was there. And there was people from all over the place kind of descended on El Paso, Texas. And the thing about Spencer is he was just in awe of everything, but he'd go practice it and he was learning every side swap and every trick. And, you know, he didn't seem to have any limits.
Oh. I was like, they collided and then the light comes out. I'm like, oh, shoot.
My trainer came out with me to the festival. And so we were working on some things, and yeah, he's a coach who works in body movement. And he looked around the room and he whispered to me, see that kid over there? He's gonna be great. And I'm like, how do you know? Because I was just in awe of someone who could look at somebody's form or body and know that they're gonna grow up to be great at whatever it is they're doing. Either it's gymnastics or tennis or even boxing, all the things that he's coached before. And he knew, not even knowing juggling, that Spencer was gonna be great at 13. And then I look at him now, I'm like, oh my God, he was right. When I look at his form, he learned early on to control the way he throws and catches. So you don't see him chasing an object that's errantly thrown, or you don't see him throwing above the pattern or letting his arms go up too high. It's highly controlled. So he was watching good form and copying that from a very early age. So you see him keeping his hands low, his shoulders are tight. You know, he's standing up very tall. And then over the years, I've heard him and seeing him posted. He said his back was hurting or he was doing this. And he knew immediately it was form. And I see him today and, you know, his back isn't sore and he's standing up much straighter. And so there's all those things with the posture and how you throw that he locked into. And you can tell as it really helps your development because you don't have to relearn something if you didn't learn it wrong the first time, like the rest of us. And you don't stop till you're... They say you don't stop develop full strength as a man until you're 28, you know, and your brain is still developing until you're at least 28. So if you think of the 7-year cycles of humanity, you know, and he's in the fourth one now from 21 to 28 years old and really still putting that mastery together. So, yeah, he's not done.
I was like,
The club's coming. Oh, there it is.
Knocking them till their head hurt. You don't want to prime with the master, but I'm the one you gotta fight after him. I'm a big problem. Make them all fall like college. Damn, make them stink like college. You don't want to get me cornered. I'ma have you down by the morning. Call up your friend. Call up big boys. You rock the party. I bring the noise. And team like, ooh, watch how we up them now. Shut the one with the big mouth. Make them get low. No king and the queen don't know. Two for one deal. Gotta get both. Trying to get started. I'm tooling the back. I'm getting the boss with a spar. With 300 warriors coming like Spartans. I'm charging like Call of Duty. You better enhard in my arm. Is coming ahead to talk regardless. I'm already, I'm bullheaded. I got a mission to hit them with a chill. As soon as I get the feeling, I'm pinning my enemies. Then they hit them, can't get rid of me. Won't stop, Kennedy won't pop. Come on, let's go. Don't come to me like woo. Why you brought beats to my door? You ain't coming. Cause I'm a thriller when it's war. Expect me to knock on the door. You know I'm coming. Control your breathing. Soon you know you're gonna need it. Just know when you see me. Survival, it will not be easy. Let's go. Let's go. Check me out. Yeah. Come on, let's go. Just know when you see me. This is kind of not easy.
When I told you, it's making it easy.
Don't ask about the focus, I have no idea what happened there. But one of the things which impresses me most about Spencer's juggling is his ability to catch and control clubs, especially when maintaining 6 and 7 club patterns. I could talk about Spencer's juggling all day, but I won't. At the time of this video, Spencer is 21. We did interview his dad, his cousin Lucas who taught him how to juggle, and a few of his friends, but we didn't manage to fit everyone into this video. But they all say that Spencer is very wholesome and kind. Spencer comes across as a person who always wants to do the right thing. Silently I wake for love, but honestly it'll never come. In my room is where everyone watching this knows I'm not going to put Spencer down or make him look like a bad person. And for that reason, it's very hard for me to express how nice and kind I think Spencer is. I only spent 2.5 weeks with Spencer, and I mean this, I think he's one of the kindest people I've ever met. DB update. As Spencer didn't get the DB, probably because it's insane. Spencer did think he was very close to the DB. Therefore, we did decide to go have us on a membership for the hall with the high ceiling, as it costs $10 per day without a membership, and his normal gym wasn't high enough. I personally wasn't feeling very positive about him getting it, because we started the membership at the end of April and he starts his first juggling touring job in the second week in June. Therefore, this only really gives him 5 weeks to get the DB. And on top of all that, he was in his last month of exams, then graduation, plus he had shows to do, which were scattered around date-wise and location-wise.
Spencer!
So he had around 8 dB sessions, from the 1st of May to the 24th of May. And I hate to be negative, but all of them were unsuccessful. He said he can't really fit in another session before he starts his touring job, because there was too much happening all at once. He says it's a little bit demotivating because it feels so close, but just not close enough. This just shows you how hard the shake actually is, especially if Spencer cannot do it with a 7 club control. Jack Denger says Spencer is probably most likely currently the best club juggler in the world right now. But this hasn't been a waste of time, as from Spencer's attempts we can all see that the DB is now possible. But there's just no one on this planet with a high enough skill level yet. And was it Mother's Day recently?
And that was my birthday. March 1st.
Spending my time with Spencer got me thinking about different types of motivation. I'm not sure how to say this, but I will try my best. I think how someone is motivated will have a massive effect on their potential. For example, I would struggle to juggle like Spencer. I get hooked on something and I need to do it every single day. If I have a couple of days off, I lose motivation and my brain gets interested in something else. For example, editing this video. But Spencer can easily have a week off and still feel inspired to juggle. We both get motivated and inspired in different ways. There are other factors which affect motivation, E.G. the way you take criticism, how you feel when you see other jugglers, the purpose or the reason why you want to learn how to juggle or get better at juggling, and there are many others as well, for example, how many hobbies you actually have. Looking at this graph, this juggler has a maximum motivation level of 40 points. You can see he gets a lot of his motivation from seeing other jugglers. Therefore, the more conventions he goes to or the longer he spends on Instagram, this area will increase. If he receives some criticism, he might lose up to 10 points. Now, everyone has different graphs and their individual graph will change with time. This third graph is what I've estimated how Spencer's motivation would line up like within these four areas. Something which really surprised me about Spencer was how he takes criticism. I don't know the word, but he is the complete opposite of being petty. He has a very strong relationship with his mind. I don't know if that is through his religious upbringing or if it's natural, but I personally want to try and adapt this mindset. Also, the more points doesn't necessarily mean better. For example, 100 points could mean you're completely obsessed. Even if you're incredibly ill and you've just been clotheslined, you still have to do a 10-hour juggling session that day, and the next day, and the next day. Rest is critical. Therefore, finding the right balance for your style of juggling is very important. When I was younger, I was unhealthily over-motivated and this had an effect on my technical juggling level. I think there is a lot of luck in mindset and motivation type in relationship to someone's juggling. And what I mean by that is, if Spencer was a creative juggler, he might not feel the benefits from his mindset and motivational type, making him a mediocre juggler instead of the beast that he is today. When we call someone talented at a task which requires skill, not strength or speed, mindset and motivation type might be more important than someone being naturally good at that certain task. I want to thank everyone who contributed to this video. There are too many names to list. But I personally want to thank Ivan for his incredible juggling knowledge and his willingness to help Spencer and I with this video. While I was driving to my mum's for dinner, Spencer video called me. I obviously pulled over because I'm a sensible man. His t-shirt was drenched, he had sweat running down his face, and he had a massive smile on his face, and he said to me, "I got it." Spencer's membership officially ran out in the third week of May. This forced him to have a whole week off from grinding the DB. In the morning of the 31st of May 2023, Spencer Androli woke up feeling fresh and inspired, and with 10 bucks in his pocket, he decided to give it one more go.
It's done. Oh, jeez.
We did it, Lewis.
Oh, jeez. DB975 through Oma Clubs. It's possible. Oh, jeez. Please be filming.
Spencer is currently on tour in California until October. He says he misses his home gym, but he still has time to practice here and there. As Spencer and I go our separate ways, we're both moving on to bigger adventures. It is important to not become complacent and let your life stagnate. It can be scary going on adventures, because you know the things ahead are probably not going to be as comfortable as what you're leaving behind. But it almost never matters where you go or what you do, it's the people. Or in our case, it's the jugglers. Sometimes I don't think we realise until time passes at how special the terms we have were. And that is why we take pieces of them with us.
So lucky.